And as we continue with who are we, as just a quick recap of last week, that first Jesus will ask, who do men say I am? Or the word asks, who do you say I am? And God will, and we will give many different answers. We will tell God of what we heard. We will tell God about our past experience. We will tell God even what we think. But then when we are still and hear ye him, Holy Spirit, we will then receive the right answer. And we can acknowledge who he is, and we can begin to understand who we are. Because when we begin to understand who our God is, we begin to understand who we are. Then also we talked about in Isaiah 43 that God tells us that he calls us by name, that he knows us. And for more and for any other reason than that we are to know our God and be known as we are known. Then we come to Revelations chapter 2 and 17, where he says he calls us by our new name. But no longer are we walking in past familiarities or accomplishments or failures or whatever that we have come to understand ourselves in. To understand that we are not what we do, we are not what we experience, but we are all the truths that God said that we are. Everything that he has spoken that we are, we are.
Amen.
Everything that he says that we can do, we can do. Everything he says that we can attain it. So therefore, we don't rely, on where we've been, where we came out of, or even what people said about us. Those things have no bearing on us. Just like Minister Aisha ministered, that yes, that she has education, but she said that she barely got it. Likewise with me, when I graduated high school, it was by God's grace that I graduated. Because I wanted, still even then, trying to fit myself in the labels that people put on. So even though I had intelligence and not bragging, I was very smart. At the same time, I hid my intelligence because I was ashamed of my intelligence, because it was not cool to be intelligent. It wasn't cool to be a nerd. It wasn't cool to be smart. So I hid it. So when people see me actually walk by my desk and see my grades, my peers would be like, you got a 95. You got a 100.
Yeah.
I thought you were slow. Wow, really? Okay. No, I am not. So, even though I had the capacity to do the work, I wouldn't be like everybody else. Everybody else wasn't trying to be smart.
Right.
But I should be, don't be like everybody else. Very stupid. Because even Paul said, to compare yourself with yourself, by yourself, is foolish. So why are you comparing yourself with yourself, but others? Why are you not coming to me and asking me, who am I? Which was a funny thing, because my sister, when she was young, used to constantly ask, who am I? And at first, you know, child asked you that, like, you're blah, blah, blah. That's your name. Who are you? Do you not know your name? Me. And you get to understand that they're not asking my surname or what you have named, but who am I? Why am I here on this earth? Why is my being present? What is my purpose? Why am I here? Can you tell me who my identity is? And you begin to understand, I can't tell you that. Especially after I got saved, I'm like, sister, I can't tell you who you are. I can't tell you your purpose. One thing I can tell you is that to seek God begin asking him who you are, that you begin to look up to him, and he will tell you who your purpose, who you are, what you are here for, that you are made to glorify him, that you are set in his image. And then as you begin to build your relationship, he will then tell you who you are. And even as I stand here, I'm gonna be honest with you. I'm still coming into being of who I am.
Amen.
Amen.
That as Paul said that he died daily, I die daily to what I thought I was.
Right.
What I die daily to how I thought I should be and act and move. And understanding that I have my, in him I live, I breathe, and I have my being in him. That I understand that my identity is the established state of ownership of oneself, remaining consistent under pressure or conditions as acceptance or agreement to the foreknowledge of God. I'll say that again. Identity, the established state of ownership of oneself, remaining consistent under pressure or conditions as the acceptance or agreement to the foreknowledge of God. Meaning, before I was, I am. I am not the great I am, but I am. What does that mean? What does it mean to say I am? I am everything that he has said that I ever was. If he says, not yet, he says that I am the redeemed of the Lord, so I am the redeemed.
Amen.
He says that I have been set free. I have been set free. He says that I am healed by his stripes, so by his stripes I am healed. So, as I come into understanding, as I come into knowledge of who of and what he has said about me, I am that. Let's turn to, first of all, let's go to Acts chapter 19. When you have it, say amen. And God brought special miracles by the hands of Paul. So from his body. So from his body was brought unto the sick handkerchiefs and aprons. And the diseases departed from them, and evil spirits ran out of them. Then certain of the vagabond Jews, exorcists, took upon them to call over them which had evil spirits by the name of the Lord. Lord Jesus, saying, we adjure you by Jesus, whom Paul preached. And there were seven sons of Sceva, a Jew that Judah, chief of the priests, which did so. And the evil spirit answered and said, Jesus I know, Paul I know, but who are you? And the man in whom the evil spirit was leaped on them, and overcame them, and prevailed against them. So they fled out of the house naked and wounded. And this was known to all the Jews in Greece, also dwelling at Ephesus, and fear fell on them, and the name of the Lord Jesus was magnified. And many that believed came and confessed and showed their deeds. And many of them which used curious arts brought their books together and brought them before all men, and they counted the price of them, and found their 50,000 pieces of silver. So mightily grew the word of God and prevailed. Why is that important? Because as we read, we understand that Paul knew exactly who he was. Just as Daniel 11:32 says, they that know their God shall be strong and do great exploits. That Paul knew so much of who he was that he didn't question. That the presence of God just settled on him, and God can work mightily through him. So as we begin to come into understanding of who we are, God can work mightily through us. Even as the word declares in 2 Samuel 22:35, that he teaches our hands to war. And what does it mean that he teaches our hands to war? Just as with a martial artist, that they learn to temper their body, their mind, their spirit, they become one. That they become weapons of war, weapons of warfare. That in battle, that even barehanded, they can take on a sword. Even barehanded, they can bring down a horse and rider. So, in our Christian walk, we learn to become weapons of war to the enemy, to bring down kingdoms of darkness, to uproot, tear down, and pluck up, and to plant as the Lord leads us. In Romans 8:29, it says, For whom he did foreknow, he also did predestinate to be conformed to the image of his Son, that he might be the firstborn of many. In Exodus 3:14, God says to Moses, I am that I am. So, when we begin to understand who we are, and we begin to understand who sent us, and we begin to understand that I am this, when we begin to understand our sonship, and people ask us, who do you think you are? We stop worrying about the faces of men. We stop worrying about the accolades of men. We stop worrying about the acceptance of men. Because I used to be in the thought that, well, they don't get me. They don't understand me. And the whole time he's saying, yes, so what? Of course they don't understand me. I never meant for every person to understand. I meant for you to be so sure, so strong in your identity that nothing will change you. Not how they looked at you, not how they perceived you, not what they even said about you. Not even them putting you in their nice little fit package because that's what made sense to them. And so what made sense to them is how they could receive it. Well, he speaks this way. He carries himself that way. So I'll place this label on. And in times past, I accepted that label. Because it was easy to walk with them in agreement instead of just being as what the word was continuously coming to me. How good that you receive yourself, how I see it. So that even when Moses asked God, okay, you're sending me to be your people's deliverer. You're sending me to be your representation. But who do I say sent me? When they ask who do I think I am? Who gave me the authority? God said to him, I am who I am. Say this to the Israelite people. I am has sent me to you. So when the facts of our life, when people ask, who do you think you are? Who do you think you are to do this? Who has qualified you? What has qualified you? Do you have the experience necessary? If you were asked me anytime last year or 3 years ago or 7 years or 10 years from now, but me ago, would I be in the position that I'm in now? And I would be like, no, I would not have saw myself being international to go to India. I would not have saw myself running an R&D area. I would not have saw this. Because my thoughts would have been, well, I don't have the education for this. I don't have the experience for this. I don't have for the knowledge to say I am qualified to run this area. But God says my grace is sufficient for you. And because my grace is sufficient, I have qualified. I have predestinated for this area. So you need not man to teach you. You need not man to qualify. You need not man to sit and say, that boy, you go. You can do this because now you have the experience, you have the knowledge, you have the education, you have the certain, the pedigree backing the obedience. God says, no, I'm going to place you in areas. I'm going to put your feet, I'm going to bring your feet to areas. I'm going to bring your name up in places that your feet have not even entered the room. They say, I want you here. They belong here. Because I said so. And just like that, even when people say, well, he's not qualified to be this. Because God says that I hold the heart of the king in my hand, I turn it any way I want. And because I turn their heart, they don't say, they can only say what I say.
That's it.
So he has the king to say, yeah, he's not qualified, but I want him.
That's right.
You might think he's not qualified. And it's very well maybe true. He is not qualified. He doesn't have the degree to actually be over this area. But I want him there. Even in the spirit realm, God begins to show us who we are. Tell us who we are. Even when Jesus was led into the wilderness and the enemy wanted to know, who are you? Like, he came down with questions, well, if you be the Son of God, do this. If you be the Son of God, do that. And the Word, being who he is, always responded with the Word. He always responded from the identity of the Word, of the truth. Because as the Word tells us that grace and truth came in through him. So he understood fully who he was. He I don't have to prove to you who I am. And let the pieces fall where it may, so that you will understand that I don't have to feed myself. For every word that proceeds from the mouth of God, that shall I live by. That I don't have to establish my own, that I don't have to receive your kingdom, neither do I have to establish my own kingdom. Because yeah, your glory, your glam looks good. But the Lord thy God shall I worship, worship only. So the I am-ness of God. I am not the great I am, but I am who I am because of who He is. In the spirit realm, because we have to understand our dreams is the spirit realm. That we understand that our dreams is our, is the moment, is not the only moment, but the moments that we are still enough, God can show us things. He can give us greater dynamics of the inside of who we are. Is that the only way? No. And Holy Spirit has been dealing with me of translating who He has showed me in the spirit realm into my natural. In the spirit, I know. In the spirit realm, I'm like, okay, God, I can do great and mighty things. But how do I do this in my waking? And He begins to walk, to tell me, as you submit to me, as you trust me with your whole heart, as you lean not to your own understanding but acknowledge me, I will direct you. For me, is that the easiest thing? No. There's times that, yes, I do lean upon my scientific teaching, that I lean to past knowledge, and I'm like, yeah, that might have served me in other ways. That might have served me times before, but it don't serve me now. Because there's times past when things that we knew got us to a certain level, got us to a certain point. But then we begin to understand, as He begins to show us and reveal us, some things just don't work no more.
Right.
It gets to a certain point where if you want to go further, if you want to go beyond this, you got to begin now. As Paul said, I count those things as lost. I count it as dumb. It doesn't matter. Paul says, I'm the chief of Jews. My background, I'm top dog. I count. So, if you want to ask me who I am, yeah, I got the degree, I got the backing, but I don't mean nothing. Even as, like I was saying, as Holy Spirit shows me who I am, there are some that talked about how busy the enemy is. There are some that talk about how the enemy is on it. But even from my youth until now, Holy Spirit has been showing me, I've called you to be a demon slayer. I've called you to be one who brings down the enemy's kingdom.
Amen.
And it's funny, that just a couple of instances. In one dream, I seem to be overtaking, what I mean by overtaking is a race. And I'm feeling tired, which in most cases, in some instances in my life, and probably you have felt also that you feel overwhelmed, you feel like you've been overtaken. And that small, still voice, which is Holy Spirit, well, how you talk to me, you just gonna give up. You just gonna let them win. You just gonna fall behind. You can do better. There's more in you. The fight ain't over yet. And so I speed up. I begin to jump over hurdles. I begin to jump over things that seem to be a blockage. As David said, I leap over the walls. I run through the troops. And as I begin to feel that strength rise up in me, because greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. In that moment, question, where did he come from? I didn't see that happening. I thought I beat him. I thought I won. And the other one said to him, that's just who Maurice is. When you think you beat him, when you think that you've won, he comes back.
Okay.
I'm like, wow, God. And I'm amazed, but at the same time, I'm like, okay, Lord. So you're showing me that the enemy already is familiar with me. He's acquainted with me. Just as with Job, that we look at Job and we're amazed by Job, but the fact that God qualified Job. God recommended Job. He's like, enemy came, it's like, well, where you been? Well, you know, going to and fro. Oh, okay, well, since you've been to and fro, then obviously you had to notice my servant Job. Yeah, I noticed that. But I can't touch him. Got a head around him. So what else? Okay, well, I'm going to remove the head. You can touch him. That I got so much confidence in him that I know that he's going to pass any test. I know he won't fall. And God said, you can touch everything up, but it's not his soul. His soul is mine. And so likewise, Holy Spirit has been showing me, you are so much stronger than you think you are. You're so much bigger than what you think. You're not small. Even to another dream where I fought a spirit. Well, I'm just going to call it what it was, a demon. And it said to me, just as I was about to be it, it said, you are as strong as they said you are. I just had to find out if you was really that strong. I was like, wow, okay. I'm glad to met your standard again. I'm glad that I didn't let you down. But now that you have found out what you needed to know, now off with your head. Just as another one that I fought, it said that you are quite interesting. Never before have I met one that has lasted this long with me. And this was a principality. It wasn't really a demon, but... And so God has been showing me, you're so much bigger than who you are, what you think. That's why I constantly keep telling you, I would that you would see yourself how I see you. I would that you would see yourself how your leaders see you. So I had to start putting away the small-mindedness. I had to start putting away the lower bar thinking. I had to start putting away and tearing off the labels that I allow people to put on me. I had to start breaking out of the box that I allowed myself to be placed in, and even that I placed myself in. Just as I forget who wrote But in it, it states, who am I that I should be great? Who am I that I should not shine? Who am I that I should not allow myself to be bright? Because I am not small, I am not insignificant. And in fact, that by me shining, by me being great, that I give others permission to shine. I give others permission to be great. That's why all the creation groans and moans for the manifestation of the sons and daughters of God, because they're waiting for someone to give them permission to be great. Amen. They're waiting on someone to tell them, to show them that you are not small. You don't have to bow down to your circumstance, what you've been through, but where you've been and where you come from. What you experience and where you've been does not define you. Because as we begin to understand who we are, as in Genesis 1 and 36, God said, let us make humanity in our image and in our likeness, that they would have dominion and rulership over everything, over the flying fowl, the creeping thing. That is very being, it's very essence. He fashioned us. He created us. He placed in us the same authority that he had. He said, I've given it to you over within this world. So we learn that with our mouth, just as he spoke everything into existence, I have the same authority to speak my world or to speak the world that he is fashioned for me, because he has a kind of righteousness for me to place me on if I just acknowledge him. If I just trust him, if I just do not lean to my own understanding, he gives me the right path. He says, I give you the way to go. I give you your answer. Even he says that if I will place my burdens on him and learn of him, because his yoke is easy, his burdens are light. Just got to trust him. That if I was to honestly say that, especially when I'm in the gym, that I feel like a titan, that I feel that nothing else matters. Because even when I used to go to the gym, I was still trying to shrink into a small place that I don't want nobody to see that I got strength. I don't want nobody to think I'm trying to show off. Now I'm trying to live in ego. So I'm just going to live life. Work a little bit smaller. And the Holy Spirit asked me, what are you doing? That this ain't what you asked me. And what I mean by that when I was 9, angel Lord came to me and asked, he said, what would you have the Lord to do unto you? And I was like, well, I asked for wisdom that you may teach me how to govern God's people. He gave me that. I asked for wealth, and I believe that at the right moment that would be released. So I'm like, thinking, I'm looking around, and I began to see this man in the corner, and he's lifting up boulders, and he's just tossing them over his shoulder. And I'm like, I want that same power and strength and spirit that flows in him to flow through me. Not understanding that what I was saying, that I want your grace to be able to toss aside burdens as though they was light. That it wouldn't matter that I just toss them over my shoulder. That I wouldn't even let them faze me yet. I would just toss obstacles out of the way. Because he said, that if you will speak to your mountains, that you'll believe that when you speak, that they will up and move. So when we begin to understand the weapons of our warfare, and understand that our mouth is a weapon, our faith is a weapon, that we speak to our mountains and they move, that we begin to understand, as Philippians 4, 5, and 6 said, let this mind be in you that was also in Christ Jesus, who thought it not robbery to be equal with God. And what it means to be equal, that meaning once again, that I have the same spirit in me, that same spirit that raised Jesus up from the dead, that I have that same power, that dunamis power in me, that breath, that when I speak and I believe it, I have confidence in the authority of my sonship, that my environment changes. Yeah. Then as I heard Evangelist Nolan say, I don't go to my God and tell him about my problems, but I tell my problems about what and who my God has created me to be. I tell my problems that you don't matter. I see you standing here, but you are small. As Paul said, these light afflictions do not compare to the eternal weight of glory that is to come. And not only is to come, but has come. Because once I realize that morning has come, because I die daily to who and what I was, that I die daily to what was, and what I've experienced, that I wake up to new grace, new mercy, new enabling power to do, to be, and to attain. So that even as in John 10 and 34, Jesus replied, is it not written in your law, I am saying ye are gods? And no, we're not supreme gods, but we are the gods of our world. That when we speak to our world, when we speak to our situations with the authority and the understanding that God has given us, our world changes.
Amen.
Because we are created to be world changers. We are created be the catalyst to set movements.
Amen.
For so long has the church been in a place of just wanting to be silent, just wanting to have that feel-good moment that just let us praise and worship. And Jesus is like, that is not what I create. That is not what my church is. That is not what my church is supposed to represent. That even when he said to his disciples, I send you as sheep unto wolves. But even as being sent out as sheep unto wolves, that we are not weak. We are not passive. That Jesus wasn't weak. He wasn't passive. He was confrontational. And that we have to come back to that place of boldness, of being confrontational, meaning not being problematic. Not that, no. But standing up for truth. Standing up for what is right. Not just accepting any and everything just because it fits with the culture. It fits with the trend. But nowadays our culture is so led by TikTok and Instagram. But I saw it on TikTok. TikTok said this. TikTok. TikTok showed me that. Am I saying that social media is bad? No, you can learn quite a many things. But at the same time, our greatest teacher, the Holy Spirit, who will show us all things, teach us all things, lead us into all truths.
Yes.
John 1:12-13. Says that he gave the gave the power to become, as many as that believe, he gave them the power to become the sons and daughters of God. So the moment when we first believed, when we first accepted the Holy Spirit, when we first accepted our salvation, we received power. We received grace. To become, to be everything that we could not be on our own. To do what we thought that would be impossible. Whether it's finishing college or coming up higher to be a teacher or to be a nurse or whatever God has called us to be, an entrepreneur, that we have the grace to do it. He's given us the means to do it. Because he says that I've given you everything that pertains to life and godliness. Meaning that I attended to your life first. For godliness, and as you begin, and as you understand, your godliness is just simply this: you acknowledging me and allowing my power to flow through you to do these things of your life. Because I want to show myself great through your life. I want to show myself mine, so that when people see you, like. Well, he wasn't like that when I knew him. I don't remember him like that in high school. I don't remember him coming from this day when I saw the tracks. When I saw him, they was down, they was low. But the grace changes us. It cleans us up. The grace transforms us into what we could not be on our own. The grace of God takes us from the gutters. It takes us from the alleys. It takes us from underneath the bridges of life to make us better. To bring us into palaces. To bring us into kingship and queenship. Just as even with the woman at the well, that for so long that her experience led her to a place of isolation because she didn't want to deal with the she said and he said. She knew very well the facts of her life. She knew what she'd done. She knew where she'd been. She knew that she was the whore of the city. That every man of the city probably already had her and knew her. But one day she had a preordained moment to meet a man that would forever change her life. That said, I will give you living water. As the slogan goes that thirsty. Because when she met the man that would forever change her life, she just thought that he was just another thirsty man that she was just tired of. I'm tired of the thirsty man. I'm tired of men just wanting me so I could just satisfy their itch and then I'm tossed. I'm tired of trying to fill a void that can't be filled. And Jesus said to her, if you would ask me for the water, it's like, well, I don't see you don't have anything to draw with. You don't have a cup, you don't have this, nothing. Well, how are you gonna draw this water? And he says, okay, you gonna play these games. I'll tell you what, go get the husband. Bring him back. I'll give him some water too. And she says, well, I don't have a husband. You answer correctly. And neither the last five you had wasn't yours either. Mm-hmm. Now she perceives who she's talking to. Yeah. I perceive that all the time. Really? Now you perceive you're talking to a prophet.
Yeah.
He said, neither, I'm not just a prophet, but I'm the one you've been waiting on. Mm-hmm. I'm the one that you've been waiting on to forever change your life. what she had never done. To take her story. To take her shin. And be the launching pad to change the city. To set her in movement. Hey, I know I met men. And I told you about men, but come meet a man. Come and meet a man that will tell you about your life and change your life. If you have the, if you receive the grace of truth to be transformed. And it said that the city believed because of her testimony. Because she came into identity for who she really was. That I am not just this poor. I am not just where I've been. I'm not just what I've been through. But I am so much more. I am capable of so much more. Because we are capable of so much more than what we can dare to believe. And so, in closing, again, I'm just going to go over just a few of the weapons of our warfare. That our understanding is a weapon. As in Romans 4 and 7, in all our getting, get an understanding. Not our understanding, but his understanding. Because when we get his understanding, we can move in the grace. We can move in what we thought we could. We can go and attain what we thought we couldn't have. Because we begin to understand who and whose we are. Understanding that I am this. As in Psalms 107:2, that we are the redeemed of the Lord. As in John 3:16, we are the beloved of God. As in John 1:12, that we are the sons and daughters of God. As in Romans 8:37, that we are more than conquerors. That, too, praise is our weapon, as in Isaiah 61:3. That we see in 2 Chronicles 20 and 22 that praise, our praise confuses the enemy. That, as in Joshua 6 and 20, praise causes the walls of our life to fall down. That faith is our weapon, for without it, it is impossible to please God.
Amen.
That Romans 5 and 2, that by faith in grace, we are able to do. Hebrews 11 and 6 tells us that, as I said, that without it is impossible to please God. That Hebrews 11 and 2 tells us that by faith we obtain a good report. That 5, humility is my weapon. Because why is humility my weapon? Because he gives grace to the humble. See, as long as I remain low, as long as I can continue to stay out of myself and understand that it's him that empowered me, that it's him that's enabling me to do it, he says, I continue to give it to you. I continue to pour it on you. But when you begin to get pride and think that you yourself done it, I resist you. I understand that my mouth is a weapon. As in 2 Corinthians 10, 4 through 6, that I pull down strongholds, that I cast down imaginations and high things that exalt itself against the knowledge of God, and I bring every thought into captivity to the obedience of Christ. That as in Isaiah 41 and 15, that my mouth is made into a threshing. A threshing instrument to tear down mountains, so that my feet, that I can make my high places low. And I understand that grace is my weapon. That as in 1 John 2:27, but the anointing which ye have received of him abideth in you, and ye have that no man teach you. So that even when I feel that I'm not qualified, even when others say that you are not qualified, Holy Spirit says, I will be your teacher. I'll be your mentor. I'll show you. I'll teach you. So yeah, you don't have not downing education. But Holy Spirit says, if you want to be an entrepreneur, ask me, I'll teach you. Holy Spirit says that if you want to know how to be a counselor, teach me, I'll show you how to take those things from your life and speak from your life that people will that people will say, hey, you've been through the same thing I've been through. You've been in this low place just like me. That you've been an addict just like me, and God cleaned you up and turned you around. That you've been a whore just like me, and God changed your life and turned you around. Wherever we came from, whether we was from the drug dealer to whatever, Holy Spirit says, I can take every matter of person and everything of concept that you have come from, and I can use it for my good. Because we understand that grace is the enabling power given to every believer to do, to be what he or she cannot do or be if left to his or her own means. That by ourselves, no, we cannot. But in him and through him, we can do all and be all. That even my relationship with God is my weapon. Because in Genesis 5:24, it says that, from the Amplified, and Enoch walked in habitual fellowship with God. What does my habitual relationship with God will do? I'll quickly turn to Isaiah 43. I'll just go ahead and read it. Isaiah 43:1-7. But now thus saith the Lord that created thee, O Jacob. And here we can insert our own name. And he that formed thee, O Israel, fear not, for I have redeemed thee. I have called thee by thy name. Thou art mine. When thou passest through the waters, I will be with thee. And through the rivers, they shall not overflow thee. When thou walkest through the fire, thou shalt not be burned, neither shall the flame kindle upon thee. For I am the Lord thy God, the Holy One of Israel, thy Savior. I gave Egypt for thy ransom, Ethiopia and Sheba for thee. Since thou wast precious in my sight, thou hast been honorable, and I have loved thee. Therefore will I give men for thee, and people for thy life. Fear not, for I am with thee. I will bring thee thy seed from the east and gather thee from the west. I will say to the north, give up, and to the south, keep not back. Bring my sons from afar and my daughters from the ends of the earth. Even everyone that is called by my name, for I have created him for my glory. I have formed him, yea, I have made him. So my relationship, our relationship to God, is our weapon. 8:34 NLT. Who then will condemn us? No one. Starting at verse 33. Romans 8:33 and 34. Who dares accuse us, whom God has chosen for his own? No one, for God himself has given us right standing with himself. Who then will condemn us? No one, for Christ Jesus died for us and was raised to life for us, and he is sitting in place of honor at God's right hand, pleading for us. So then, I end with, if God be for us, who can be against us? And if God be for us, then who are we? For we are his sons and daughters, to stand in his power, to stand in his authority, and be life changers.
Amen. Amen.